There we go.
Alright, Monica, I hope you can hear this.
Hi, Monica.
Dr. Sanders.
I love Dr. Sanders. He's
somebody, alright, last word. Tacos, alright, yay! Alright, thank you. So, we are planning to have the possibility of asking a lot of questions tonight. And let's see if I can make this advance. We have two options for asking questions. One is if you have a smartphone, you can go to Slido.
Have you seen this?
Just up here. To post the questions. And the event code is 3843. And you'll see live any questions you put up. You can also do a little thumbs up for other people's questions that you like. And I'll be collecting them. And we'll try to answer some of them at the end. If you don't have a smartphone or you don't want to use it, we also have cards. Britt has them here, and in the Q&A, she'll be coming around and pass them out if you want one. So please participate in the discussion both during our presentation, and then there will be a reception at 6, followed by another group discussion in the room across the hall. So you've got lots of opportunities to be part of this. A couple of quick announcements. There's a slide at the end for selfies. I'm sure hardly anyone in here is after extra credit, but if you are, there's a slide at the end. And the organizers wanted me to let you know as well that there are two more facticity panels in the spring, February 13th and March 13th. So keep those, watch out for those. So, you know, we have kind of an interesting topic to deal with tonight, truth and lies. And I thought, as a historian, it might be fun to bring in the words of a German playwright from the 1930s, Bertolt Brecht, who tried to sort of think about what it meant to tell the truth in a public place. This is a quote from one of his pieces from 1935. Nowadays, anyone who wishes to combat lies and ignorance and to write the truth must overcome at least five difficulties. One must have the courage to write the truth when truth is everywhere opposed, the keenness to recognize it, although it is everywhere concealed, the skill to manipulate it as a weapon, the judgment to select those in whose hands it will be effective, and the cunning to spread the truth among such persons. I think all four of our presenters today are going to be touching on some of these issues, the issues of courage, keenness, skill, judgment, cunning. And so I'd like to introduce our panel and have them come forward. I'm going to go ahead and introduce them all at the beginning, and then they'll speak in turn. So from Wins Truth, Melissa Teehee from Psychology. Competing Truths, Jennifer Peoples from Communication Studies. Manufacturing Truth, Jason Gilmore from Global Communication. And Fake News, Kathy Bullock from Journalism and Communication. So
yeah, Dr.
please join
Baldwin.
Me in welcoming all our speakers. So I'm going to turn it over to Melissa to start, and you can start sending questions in at any point if something comes to your brain.
This is an awareness test. How many times has the team in white passed the ball?
Thank you.
what underlies that is what we judge to be really important. So underlying sort of the things that I just talked about and perception is our worldview. And our worldview is the shared values and assumptions and customs, norms, and things that our institutions are based upon. It's really the psychological perception of what the world, of like our perception of the world and what we determine to be true, what leads us to think, feel, and behave differently. So our worldviews really are sort of, our values are oftentimes under there with that, and that shapes our beliefs, and from there shapes how we think, how we act, right? So to go along with this is this idea of sort of cultural and societal programming. So this is, how do we get our information, right? How do you know what our values are, right? These are things that we sort of start to really grasp and grow from a very, very early age. And these come from many places, and I have just put a couple up here, right? So parents and family, religion talks about what our values are, behaviors, our school, right? So what the curriculum is, the history that you learn, the media, who you see represented on TV, how they are represented. Those things all shape our perception. And then our news sources. So if you ever look at different news sources, if you look at news sources at all, those are things that oftentimes contradict. But if you are only looking at one source of news, you sort of get a different perception of things. So what about when you are faced with facts that challenge your sort of cultural, social programming, and your beliefs? How do people react to that? So looking at behavior and psychology, we have an attentional bias, right? So that is the tendency to pay attention to some things while simultaneously ignoring other things. So in that video, the important thing was how many times the people in white passed the ball. You did not count how many times the people in black passed the ball. And a bunch of people who've never seen the video before missed the gorilla, right? So what was important in that moment is what you paid attention to. Confirmation bias is when we sort of seek out information that confirms our beliefs, our values, our perception, and we do not seek out information that would contradict that at all. So oftentimes we'll overlook that, or that was a one-time thing, right? That wasn't statistically significant. That's not likely to happen again. These other things are. We have an attribution bias, which is really common in individualistic societies, and that's where people sort of assign cause to like a behavior or something like that to a person's individual character versus like societal norms or things that are happening within the context. So to add in here, I think one of the reasons we oftentimes believe and hold on to our beliefs in the face of other information is our ego. So we are invested in supporting the things we have long believed. It takes a lot to
know
those. And then conformity and assimilation. So that is
acting
in accord with the prevailing social standards to fit in a group. And so people in individualistic societies really want to sort of say, like, oh, I'm not a conformist, but we all are. We are all, like, sitting in a classroom right now facing the front. Like, there are rules and things that are happening all the time. So here's just a cartoon here, but this is the idea that there are more than one truth. There are more truths happening at one given time, depending on how you look at the situation. And really, there's a big difference between judging, and judging a situation in the moment is really the opposite from understanding. You cannot be understanding from another person's perspective and be judging at the same time. Language is a system of symbols. So why is this important? Because it means that the language we use is never the thing itself. Earth, the letters, sound, when I say it, earth, is a symbol. It's not the lovely blue and green land and water covered planet we inhabit. It is a symbol that English speakers use to represent this place. We can understand this relationship between the symbol and the thing more clearly when we look at some of the other symbols used to represent the planet. There is no natural relationship between the symbol and the thing. Speakers of the same language just agree what the symbol means. This becomes problematic when we try to speak a material truth, explain it to others. We're reliant on the system of symbols, and we know that even small changes in the symbol can impact the meaning of the thing we're trying to explain. Is this the Earth? World? A planet? A globe? A world? I look correct, but they have slightly different feelings, slightly different meanings. This imprecise nature of language is always at play when we try to articulate a truth. For example, we know the Earth is warming. This is a physical reality. For those whose livelihoods require being accurate, rational, and factual, such as those in the sciences, they try to get their symbols as close to the material reality as language allows. As we attempt to explain the broader issues and concerns having to do with the warming Earth, concepts that are more abstract maybe than temperature, symbols play an even greater role. Is what we are experiencing, climate change, global warming, a natural phenomenon, human-caused catastrophe? How do we ensure climate justice? Are we now in the Anthropocene? And what the heck is the Anthropocene? Because we're required to use symbols to communicate, even a whole dictionary's worth, we can never perfectly represent the complexity and all the aspects of material reality. But that doesn't mean that all symbolic constructions are equally true. For example, to say that the planet is cooling, or global warming is a hoax, does not match the material reality of a warming planet. You can say it, but it still isn't accurate or true. In fact, some would say it's a lie. To say someone is lying in the technical sphere of science, research, law, or fabricating information as a journalist can have serious consequences. It doesn't, however, work the same way in the public sphere, the place where people engage with each other in conversations, arguments, debates, and questions about shared substances, shared concerns, and public interests, places like this. To say someone is lying in response to a blog can backfire in the public sphere, making the speaker sound naggish, or maybe childish. It frequently doesn't work in the way it's intended. For example, even with all the fact-checking mechanisms in the last election, no one was held accountable for complete fabrications. Why? Language can give us this insight. While at times closely aligning itself with physical reality, language can also express things that are abstract. We talk about hopes and dreams and beliefs and values in the future, all things without a direct material counterpart, but are still of importance to people as they make decisions. While it's important to hold people accountable, whether they're speaking of concrete facts or abstract realities, as we can see from the case of President Reagan, that can be difficult. In his speeches, Reagan loved to tell stories. He told the one about Albert Einstein not understanding the tax form he was attempting to fill out. He told the one about the New York City kids not being allowed to pray in the cafeteria, neither of which were true. His nodding relationship to truth was characterized in this way in an article in the New Republic. Ronald Reagan